Hello and a warm welcome to Voice of Russia's political discussion program, Debating Russia. I'm Peter Lavelle. Russia and its image in the world. The West's mainstream media consistently paints Russia in the darkest of colors. Why is this? Is it merely the force of habit? Is it a legacy of the Cold War? And finally, does Russia do a good job presenting itself? To discuss this and more, I'm joined by my guest in London, Dmitry Linnik. He's the Voice of Russia's London Bureau Chief. We also have Marcus Papadopoulos. He's publisher and editor of Politics First and First Russia. And here with me in Voice of Russia's Moscow studio is Elizabeth Lukin. She's the editor of RT's debate program, CrossTalk. All right, if I can go to Dmitry first in London. You've lived abroad quite a few years of your life. What are some of the most obvious stereotypes about Russians, and maybe when people ask you questions about where you come from and what it's like in Russia?
Well, that's developed over the years, I guess. It's been getting progressively worse in the 16 years or 17 years that I've been living in the UK. It started out, in the early 90s, I began working for the BBC, and my idea was that, you know, it is a convergence of the two worlds, of the two medias, if you will. I used to work for the Voice of Russia before joining the BBC, so I didn't think the transition was that sort of noticeable. Similar organizations, similar ideals, if you will, similar agendas back then. It began to deteriorate slightly towards the early noughties, I guess, 2003, 2004, 2006, particularly with the death of Alexander Litvinenko. That was kind of a cutoff point and a complete change of tone in the media. And of course, the bigger picture is that it was probably it marked a serious change in policies. The media reflected
it's interesting. Yeah. It's interesting you mentioned 2003, because that's the Yukos affair, which is that's when Western capital, if we can put it that way, turned on Russia or was very, very angry with Russia. Lisa, sitting with me here in the studio, you lived 6 years of your life abroad in Pakistan.
Yes, but you went to an American school.
So that's a very interesting experience to have. In the formative years of your life, you're living in a Muslim country, going to an American school, and you're Russian. Give us a couple of examples of what that mixture meant.
Well, actually, in Pakistan, everything was rather friendly. I was small then, so I didn't really feel any political, any problems there. But basically, we traveled after Pakistan a lot with my father, and I studied in France for a while, and that was a lot later. And there we had, people came up to me and asked me very ludicrous questions. What are we made to do in Russia? Like, what is the problem in Russia? What is the problem with your country? What's the problem with human rights? That was in France. That was in France, and that was around 2005.
Okay. All right. That's when things started to deteriorate.
And everybody was asking about Putin and what are Russian perceptions of Putin. So that was pretty harsh on me, because nobody wanted to actually befriend Russians.
At a young age there, we're talking about this time period, and Hollywood had turned Russia into a gangster country. mobsters and prostitutes. I think this is what a lot of people had then and still do.
That's true. Russian gangsters. Well, towards Russian students, it's obviously different. But we're supposed to be, freedom fighters. We're the younger generations, as pictured in the West. We are supposed to be the ones who will bring all the policies now down. We will be against Putin. We will fight him. We are supposed to be like the West. Why are we supposed to be like the West? Why are we supposed to dislike our country?
Okay, that's exactly where I wanted to go. Marcus, it's one of the amazing things, particularly the United States, but in general the West over the last two centuries, they have to save Russia and even save Russians from themselves.
Well, I think a lot of it comes down to official perceptions of Russia. But, on the one hand, if you take the allegations which have been made against Russia this year, from having territorial designs on Finland to Poland, to being responsible for the terrible Malaysian airline tragedy, they are unsubstantiated, they're circumstantial, they're unintelligent, and they're irrational. But you need to get to the root of it. And of course, in the Western world, and I'm really speaking about the Anglo-Saxon countries in the world, of course, at the front of that, Britain, there's always been this view embedded within the establishments that the world is divided, is polarized into the civilized world and in the barbaric world, the Western world and the Eastern world. And certainly a lot of people in Whitehall, be it politicians, senior civil servants, they really still do believe in that view put forward by ancient Roman philosophers such as Virgil, that the people of the Orient, the people of the East, they're barbaric, they're extremely dangerous people. And that has filtered into the British official mind. And that was like that during the 1800s. It was like that during the 1900s. It was like that during the 20th century. And it's never actually left the British official mind. So the view very much today within the British government is that Russia, despite being a capitalist country, is still very much a threat to the Western world. It encompasses everything that's wrong in the world. It's barbaric, it's tyrannical, it's aggressive, it's a threat to its neighbours. So whether Russia has a czar, whether Russia has a general secretary, whether Russia has a president, the view will always be that Russia is a threat to the civilised world and to the free world.
Go ahead, Dmitry, because...
I've stumbled upon a blog... which suggests that, in all seriousness, that it's not beyond Putin to drop a small nuclear bomb on a city someplace in the Baltics, just to show that there's nothing that NATO is going to do about it. That the writer is, can we insert a peep in here? That's not the problem. The problem is that these views are carried by one of the biggest news providers in the world, by Reuters. And that's,
my goodness.
Yes, that is exactly, my goodness, yeah, and that's, well, corroborating the point that Marcus has just made.
One of the problems that I face working for Voice of Russia and also for RT is that I sometimes get the impression that you could listen to this program that we're doing right now, or you could watch Crosstalk, and if you'd never seen it before, and you'd never had anything, information about Russia beyond the mainstream, beyond Reuters, beyond CNN, BBC, a lot of people would think that we are conducting a propaganda program here, because there is absolutely no context. When I moved to Russia in 1997, I realized that almost everything I was told about Russia wasn't true. So I think the problem is the context. And as Marcus has pointed out, there are certain ideas embedded in the discourse about Russia that no one wants to examine. And that makes the context issue even more glaring. Go ahead, Dima.
One other sort of example in recent publications, and, you know, you don't have to look far. The Times says, don't rejoice at Chelsea's success. That's a football club, obviously owned by Roman Abramovich, or Abramovich, as he's called in English, because of the way the money was pilfered from the state. That is the point. I mean, Hodorkovsky, as whom you mentioned in 2003, sort of was a hero, and certainly in subsequent years. Initially, actually, there were reservations about the moral stature of Hodorkovsky, but as things rumbled on, he became this sort of knight in shining armor, anti-Putin crusader, and a hero in the eyes of the West. While Abramovich, I mean, they emerged as tycoons, as oligarchs, or whatever you call them, at the same time, using pretty much the same methods. It all originated with the infamous Yeltsin's election campaign in 96. That's where they made their colossal money, their billions. So Abramovich is now sort of not a likable character, while Hodorkovsky, is this white and shining armor, as I said.
You know, Marcus, if I can go to you, I mean, John D. Rockefeller was a man that was hated in his lifetime. He became the richest man in the world, bar none, and the media went after him too, and for very good reasons, because he was a mobster of sorts. He created a system that made him immensely wealthy, and then you have Mr. Putin, and he gets three cheers for it in Russia, is that he cut these people down to size. They pay their taxes. They don't buy political parties. They stay out of politics. That was the deal that Putin made. It's a very good deal from the point of view of Russians, but from the outside world, well, Mr. Putin put an end to a lot of lucrative ideas that the West had about Russia.
Well, and, you know, for the West, the greatest crime that President Putin has made is actually putting Russia's house back into order, is bringing back stability and security to the country. Because if you look in the 1990s, yes, NATO started to expand to Russia's western borders, because, as I said earlier, that view of Russia is still embedded in London, in Washington, and I believe also in Paris. But you didn't have that sort of stern criticism of Russia in the 1990s. Why? Because you had a hopeless, weak, pro-Western, subservient president in the Kremlin in the form of Boris Yeltsin. That all changed in 2000 when President Putin made it very clear that Russia was an independent sovereign country and had every right to pursue its foreign policy objectives on the international scene. And that's really the blueprint for what we have today, because the West will never, ever be able to see Russia in a positive way when it has someone in the Kremlin who is looking out for the country's interests and for the ordinary Russians' interests.
Lisa, let me go to you. And Marcus was very smart in what he had to say there, because it's a Russia that can say no now. But, you know, you and I working together, we see how the Russia story is always framed. And you sent me a New York Times headline a few days ago. What was it?
Yes, that made me really, really angry. The New York Times ran the story of Poroshenko discussing the ceasefire with Russia. It was a ceasefire with Russia. How can this be actually true if Russian troops are not... This is an internal crisis of Ukraine. This is not a matter of Russia and Ukraine.
No, Lisa.
It is
because
just geared to
if it was an internal... Oh, no. Because if it was an internal crisis, then you have to go to the events of February 22nd.
Of course.
Right? Okay. And this is, again, the media war that we're in now, because there are two absolutely divorced narratives. Because if it's an internal event, then the culpability of the Newland cookies, let's put it that way, all right? But if it's Russia, well, then, of course, you know, it's this Goliath beaten up on this little tiny, you know, all they want is European values and freedom. I mean, it's a very simple formula, but you're right. I mean, if you frame it that way, it draws certain conclusions.
Yeah. And it's funny that, well, obviously you mentioned Newland. You cannot not mention Newland in this conflict. I remember that we had a guest on CrossTalk who didn't even know who she was. And he was in Washington, and he was defending Washington's position. How crazy is that? How you can actually judge anything and say anything about the conflict if you don't know the key people there?
Let me go back to Dima, because by the default position is, you know, if there's a problem, you have to find out how Russia got us there. That's the default position here. I find it really troublesome, because the kind of environment that we live in right now is, you know, there's no going back. And this is one of the things I think we've seen with this Ukraine crisis, is that we've seen a major turning point. This isn't a blip. This isn't Georgia 2008. This is something far more serious.
Well, it is, isn't it? I don't know. I don't want to probably go into... Well, if we do want to go deeper in history, I mean, we're almost, well, kind of, historically speaking, we're almost on 200 years since the Crimea War. The British writer-historian Orlando Figes, in his brilliant book Crimea, devotes quite a lot of attention to how the British media precipitated the war, how it actually encouraged the war. So that is a separate strain of influence that, you know, brought the situation to where it was. And I'm afraid we're seeing some of that now. Now, talking about the media aspect, I would like to sort of constrain myself to that. Putin and the Kremlin are accused of brainwashing their public with the help of television. I mean, to an extent, that's probably true. I mean, any television is a powerful instrument, and be it here or... It's the kind of ideas that this television seeks to instill in the public. I guess there sort of lies the crux of the matter. Increasingly, in the West, people... from what I've seen, do not want to believe what they're seeing on their television.
Absolutely true.
In Russia, I mean, a lot of television are not influenced by a lot of people are not influenced by television. I know that for a fact. It's also true of Russia that not everybody is buying whatever the television is projecting onto them. But interestingly, the differences are, and some are very important, the range of opinions in the Russian media is probably greater than that in the West.
Agree.
And
I
that
agree.
Is but, something well, that people here in the West are completely unaware of.
Marcus, it's very interesting. I think it was the Washington Post about a week ago was talking about exactly what Dima was just saying there, that, you know, Russians are exposed to this media propaganda from television and its media in general. But apparently it's a myth of the people in Washington and in the media in general is that almost every single major article written about Russia in not only English, but in French, in German, in other languages, is instantly, almost instantly, translated into Russian. And so if you're saying to the people, you know, people in Russia, you're brainwashed because if you like the current political arrangement in Russia, it's so insulting. I mean, this is the level of lack of knowledge of people have of Russia today.
Absolutely. And it comes down once again to ignorance. It comes down to stereotypes. It comes down to racial prejudices. I mean, you know, I don't want to sort of divert the conversation away, but even Winston Churchill during the Second World War, he once asked, are the Russian people actually human beings? And he equated the Russian people to the orangutan. So you can see just how embedded it really is in the West. But I think, you know, going back to about media outlets, I think we have to be fair and clear that every major organization in the world has an agenda. And I think that's a reasonable thing to point out. But I do believe in Britain, for example, things are changing. You know, the mainstream media in this country don't have the feel to themselves like they did during the wars in the former Yugoslavia, leading up to the invasion of Iraq. People are starting to question more and more what they mm-hmm. hear, for example, on the BBC, what they hear on Sky News, what they read in the Times, what they read in the Guardian. And I do believe that the vicious response from a lot of Western journalists towards organizations like Voice of Russia and RT, it's a reflection of how they know they don't have the feel to themselves anymore, and they are getting exposed. They're getting exposed on social media, they're getting exposed on the radio, they're getting exposed on the television. So I think their negative, vicious responses is actually a positive.
It's really interesting because I think, well, you know, historians will reflect upon what happened in August of last year when the vote went to the House of Commons for a military strike against Syria, and they got a resounding no, and that sent a shockwave to the U.S., which caught Obama again off balance here. So absolutely all these other elements out there. I would like to say also, reflecting what Dima said, that sure, I think every news agency, major news agency, particularly television, has an agenda, but smart audiences go to other sources to check as well. Lisa, do you want to jump in?
Yes, I do want to jump in. About RT, for example, where I work, it's really easy for me to say, speak for that. It is absolutely true that every single TV station, every channel, any other media in general has its own agenda, has its political line. That is very true. But as for Crosstalk, for example, we were never actually told that we should or we must make a certain program or we must take a specific guest who will say this certain points and Peter Lavelle must not contradict him in any way. We never had anything of the sort. Well, as editor of this program, I feel that I hope I should be trusted in this because this is totally true.
Well, you know, let's tell our listeners here. And we have a common email group,
yes.
And our boss is in that group, and he sees what we're doing. If he wants to jump in and say, hey, you know, I thought about this idea and all that, and he does give us ideas sometimes, but I've never gotten an order in all these years.
Absolutely, that's true. And another thing I wanted to say is that, well, in the media right now, if we read an article or we hear somebody say anything nice about Russia, why is it so that in the West it is treated that this person is either paid, he's a Putin propagandist, he's the bullhorn of propaganda, or he's just crazy, he's just a lunatic?
Yeah.
Why is it so? Why aren't these people not allowed to have their own opinion on this? This is why we're actually seeing a rise of alternative media today. There are so many websites, thanks to internet, thanks to Facebook, that are now putting pushing through this other side, this other truth that the West is not allowed to see, not allowed to hear and read.
And particularly when the rest of the world has a very different interpretation of Russia. Again, Marcus is right, the Anglo-Saxon world. Marcus, if I go back to you, it's interesting what you said earlier about how the West is civilized and civilization, and then the East is barbaric. I find it quite interesting because I see today it is the West that commits barbarism around the world. I can name all of the countries in the last 7 years that have been invaded, destroyed, broken, etc., etc. And you have a division of wealth where you have the 1% and you have the destruction of middle classes. And how dare the West talk about having values when they go around in the Arab world, in the Muslim world, and destroy countries, or never, hardly ever, penalize a country like Israel for its slaughter of people in Gaza. It's really kind of bizarre.
It is, and it's quite frankly, I think it's disgusting. But that is the view, certainly within London, and I do believe a lot of it comes down to the sense of Anglo-Saxon superiority and of the sense that people of the East, people of the Orient are actually inferior. You know, a lot of people from within the British establishment, they've had a public school education. And if you start to analyse public school educations, you will see that they teach them what, as I said at the beginning of the programme, what ancient Roman philosophers argued, what ancient Greek philosophers argued, that the world is polarised between West and East, and so on and so on. And so by the time they leave school, if they go into the army, if they become politicians, that view is embedded in their mind. And when it comes to Russia, for example, they believe that Russia remains that threat that it was to the British Empire, that it was to Britain to the Cold during the Cold War. And today, certainly as a lot of people at the Houses of Parliament believe that Russia is again showing how it's threatening nature towards Britain, how it talks to the Argentine government over the Falkland Islands, or the Malvinas, however you wish to term them. So
Marcus,
once again, to them,
Marcus,
that's more evidence.
Did you see the article that if Scotland gets its independence, Russia could invade Scotland? I couldn't believe it.
Yes, but there's talk at Parliament again about Russia weighing in on the Scottish Nationalist Party's side with this. It's absolutely ridiculous. But it does fit into that picture, that view of Russia, that it is a potent threat to Britain and to the entire Western world.
Yeah, I wonder how Western media and the halls of power in the West would react if a major Russian politician or Mr. Vladimir Putin himself went to Glasgow and expressed his opinion about the referendum. They would go completely nuts, wouldn't they? Go ahead, Dima. I can hear you laughing. Go ahead.
Yes. Well, I want to go back, actually, to the media aspect of it and and the fact that Russian people are very exposed to Western media because, a lot of the stuff is almost instantly translated. The site called so-called Inosmi, the foreign media, that translates everything and anything that's worth reading about Russia whenever Russia is mentioned in the Western press. So I want to go back to the brainwashing sort of accusation against the Russian media inside the country, I'm saying. Now, all right, some people are influenced by views that they read in the papers and on television and whatnot. The views that are projected in the Western media are ostensibly quite different from those in Russia, in the Russian state-owned media. But in my understanding, a lot of the support that Putin gets, he gets not only because the Russian people believe what they see on Russian media, but also because they don't believe what they read in the Western media. They see the sort of the irrelevance of the commentary, the complete the commentary and the information in those Western media outlets is so far removed from what they know is their reality.
Lisa, it's very interesting as some of the major columnists in the U.S. over the past couple of weeks have tried to understand what Putin is doing in Ukraine. It must be because the economy is faltering. It must be because they want to bring back the Soviet Union. It must be because Putin wants to leave a legacy. And, you know, I read these things and there's no common sense attached to it. And what Dima just said is absolutely true. When this is translated into Russian, and I look at you, you know, you're 20-something here, you must think, you know, these people must be nuts.
Yes, they are nuts because they don't know the context, as we said before. They just don't know the facts. And the thing is that the U.S. media is getting more and more opinionated. It is not about facts. It is about opinions. It is about putting your message through without backing it with anything, and very often lacking any consistent knowledge in the topic whatsoever. That is sadly what is happening quite often right now. But what I also wanted to mention is that when we say France, for example, we don't think about Hollande, right? Mm-hmm. We think about fashion, food, art. When we say Russia, we think Putin did it.
Yep. Putin,
and it is all Putin's fault, and absolutely everything. Why is this so?
Marcus, there was a former CIA functionary about a week ago said that if you just take out Putin, then it's a Putin problem, okay? And it's really quite bizarre because, the Western politicians and Western media, as an echo chamber, will never accept that Russia has its own national interest. And when it says it has a red line, it will defend that red line.
Yeah, because Russia is a resurgent country on the international stage. And that's what the fear is all about. If it was the Russia of the 1990s, there wouldn't be this tension that there is today. But I think that what has happened this year between Russia and the West, it's extremely serious. And it's long term. There's not going to be a severing of diplomatic relations between Russia and America and Russia and Britain, etc. But certainly, I think that it's long term. And I think it will get worse, because if we believe that the situation in Ukraine is going to simmer down, which I don't believe it will, but if it will, the Americans are already eyeing up Georgia. They're already eyeing up Moldova. So there's going to be a Ukraine again in the Caucasus. There's going to be a Ukraine in Moldova. Where does it end? And it all comes down to that the West is very insecure at the moment, and it is doing everything it can to try and weaken a resurgent Russia and protect its global dominance in the world.
Dima, I always get the impression that Russia is the evil twin of the West. All of the sins that the West commits, it projects upon Russia, because it's just part of the genetic code of the narrative when it comes to international politics.
Well, what Marcus has said at the beginning of the program, this sort of underlying racist attitude, mm-hmm. in essence, that's what it is. It's also, there's this definition introduced by, I believe, Nick Curtis, a British political scientist and writer. The word is unpeople. And that sort of encapsulates entirely what the attitude is about. Now, people and countries in the media are normally, particularly in the civilized West, protected by ethics, by journalistic standards, by libel laws, finally. But it doesn't seem to apply to Putin, certainly. It doesn't seem to apply to Russia, increasingly, the Russian people. It seems political correctness does not encompass Russia. That is patently and basically at base, it is racist. It's xenophobic.
And there's a galling double standard, because when these horrific videos of Western journalists being beheaded by ISIS, and ISIS is sending it out as a message, but there was very little commentary that during the same time period, well, in 1 week, Saudi Arabia beheaded 19 people. It never made mainstream media. No one ever talked about that. Where does Saudi Arabia belong in the morality pantheon? It's in the West. It's a Western friend. But all of its crimes and its hideous behavior towards its own people, it's all covered up. But then again, you know, when Russians are dying, ethnic Russians are dying in eastern Ukraine, it's somehow they deserve it because they're Russian.
They are unpeople, exactly. And this disparaging treatment of the Kremlin leadership or of Putin and his entourage, his government, is not confined to just this political elite. It's now increasingly, in my evidence, includes virtually all Russians. It is that. So that is fundamentally racist, colonialist, if you will. That, I think, is the essence of it all. That is the essence of the policies, and that is the essence of what the media are doing to service those policies.
All right, we've run out of time. I have a fascinating discussion here. I want to thank my guests, Dmitry, Marcus, and Elizabeth here sitting with me in Moscow. You've been listening to Voice of Russia's political discussion program, Debating Russia. I'm Peter Lavelle. Stay with the Voice of Russia.